just started to see an evolution happen in him. He started to hold his hands together, and he started to kind of squeeze his eyes, and then every now and then he'd lift one of them up to see if we were still praying, you know. And then when you'd say amen, he'd say amen, you know, and he'd make some audible sound. We don't know if it was amen or not. But it's just been a lot of fun going backwards from where we currently are as a family. It was this day, 17 years ago, and very similar situation where it was around 9:30, 10 o'clock, that I was somewhere very different. I was in a hospital room, and we had Madison on the floor, and she was hanging out, and Mandy was on the table, and she was pushing really hard, and all of a sudden, pop, comes the weasel. Joe came out, is what happened. I'll never forget that day. It was so much fun because Madison's sitting in the corner. She's trying to figure out what's going on. She's just kind of keeping to herself, and all of a sudden, the doctor slaps Joe's rear end, and metaphorically. And then at the end of that, you know, Joe starts to cry because he just went through something he'd never gone through before. And he's, ah! And all of a sudden, Madison goes, what is that? It's kind of been like that ever since in my home, right? A little bit of a why is he here sort of feel. And then as we continue to add children, that continues to happen too. But Mandy and I, we've gone through a lot of changes just in our own personal life. And I think all of us have, haven't we, in some ways? We've all gone through changes just consistently. And I've seen those different changes manifest themselves through the last 20 years of our marriage, 18 years of having children. And to go back to Liam, to go back to those early ages, man, it's just kind of been a shell shock a little bit. It's been a lot of fun. And it's a little bittersweet for us as we say goodbye to Liam. Just the reality of it. We both knew going into this situation that at the end of the situation, we would be giving Liam back to mom. That's what our goal was. And yet the inevitable day comes and it goes and you're just kind of going, well, here it is. And so today, I had slated to talk about change and the next chapters and that sort of thing. And we've been talking about change a little bit in the office since January, knowing that this sermon series would come up, and I was talking to Dylan early, and Dylan said, oh, I got the perfect title for your series. What's that? Change Doesn't Suck. I said, no, Dylan, we're not going to go with that title. Because some of us have that attitude that, man, change doesn't suck. We're excited about change. We like change, change. Let's change this, and let's change that, and let's change this. But the older you get, kind of the more wearisome change becomes, doesn't it? Don't you just kind of like to settle in sometimes and just, you want to see things not change? Amen, somebody says. We get here pretty early, and I get here around 6 o'clock on Sunday mornings and 7 o'clock. Dave and Sue come in, Torres, and I had to reach down and grab something on the floor, and I talked to Dave, and I said, man, it just seems like the older I get, the farther the floor gets from me. I don't understand why that is, you know? You're approaching 40, and things don't move like they used to. Psalm chapter 90, verse 12 says this. I love what the psalmist writes in Psalm 90, 12. It says, teach us, O Lord, to number our days. Camp there for a little bit. Teach us, O Lord, to number our days. For then we will be wise. You see, change is inevitable. And we know that change is inevitable. All of us, we anticipate some changes. We look forward to some changes. Some changes we don't really look forward to. But we know that change is inevitable. Case in point, how many of you are looking forward to summer? Yeah, can I get an amen on that one? How many of you are looking forward to fall? All of you now are divided. This is a house divided. But we know that seasons in the year have a way of reminding us that change is constant, that change is going to continue to happen. Last Thursday night, Mandy and I were sitting out by the campfire, and we're just kind of doing life and just enjoying a good fire on a good crisp night. And I think it was right around 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and Mandy sees a ton of birds just flying west. And she goes, see, even the birds are confused. She is really looking forward to the sun coming out. For me, I'm good with it. It doesn't bother me keeping in the fall or winter seasons. But that's just our different styles. But seasons, the physical changes that are happening in our world, the grass getting greener, the buds starting to come up on the trees, it has a way of reminding us that change is inevitable. You cannot escape change. There was an old man that lived 500 years before Jesus. He even lived before Socrates. He was a pre-Socratic philosopher, and he grew up in the area of Ephesus, which is right on the western edge of Turkey, modern-day Turkey. And he grew up in a house of privilege. He had every advantage known to man. He was the son of a king. He was the first of the sons of kings, and he was slated and kind of a shoe-in to become the king of the area. And his name is Heraclitus. Okay, Heraclitus. And Heraclitus was this philosopher that as he came into life, as he came into this new season of life, this new chapter of life, he denied the throne. He gave it to his younger brother and he said, I would rather not deal with the politics in the Senate. I would rather play with the children in the streets. And I just love that sort of attitude. Not only was he a philosopher and kind of a deep thinker and he wanted to escape some of the responsibilities that he had, one of the other interesting facts for me was that he kept to himself. He was kind of a loner. If we saw a Heraclitus today, we would think something was off with him. He was maybe a half or two of a bubble off. Okay, his level, his straight bubble wasn't really straight. Something was weird to him because he kept to himself. He didn't care about a lot of people. He didn't care about humanity. You would often find him in the streets playing with children, and he would play the game that he was an Olympian at, and it involved turkey bones. It involved turkey bones. They would take the bones of a turkey neck, and they would dry them out. They would put them in a stew, and then they would put them down on the ground. And you'd sit down with your legs crossed, and basically what you would do is you'd take one of the turkey bones, and you would throw it up in the air, and you'd reach down, and you'd grab another turkey bone, and you'd try to catch that one that you threw up. And then it was the other person's turn. And the whole point of the game was to see how many turkey bones could you gather as you threw one up to catch. Sound familiar to any other game that we know? It was jacks. That's exactly what it was. It was jacks. And he would play jacks in the street all the time in his life. In fact, a lot of the politicians during his day, they would see him and they would mock him. They would kind of scoff at him and they would say, "What is wrong with you, Heraclitus? Why are you playing children's games when we could use somebody like you in the Senate?" He said, "You guys are playing games. I'm just playing a different one." That was his attitude. Amen. Amen. So he's kind of a guy, the more you study, the more interested you become in. And one of the famous sayings that he had was that change is constant. Let's go ahead and look at this quote, if you don't mind, Lars. Everything changes. Nothing will remain the same. And then he goes on to say, it is impossible to step in the same river twice. It is impossible to step in the same river twice. That's the guy that he kind of encapsulates everything that we're talking about in the next 3 or 4 weeks is that change is constant. But what do you do when you're caught in change? You see, we know that there's all kinds of seasonal changes that we're going to go through in life. We get that. But there are also physical and technical changes that we've all gone through and experienced. I want you just real quick to think with me. What is one of the most significant changes in your lifetime that you've ever seen? I want you just to ponder that for 5 seconds. After 5 seconds, share it with the person right next to you. What is the most significant change that you've ever seen in your lifetime? Go ahead and talk. What is it? What is the most significant change you've ever seen in your lifetime? Okay, let's hear it. The cell phone. Cell phone is a significant change, right? It makes us more portable. Very good. What's another change?
Having children.
Having children's a change. You bet it is. Especially when you go from 2 to 3, because now you're no longer in man-to-man coverage, you're into zone coverage, all right? Having children really changes everything. It's a game changer. And by the way, let me just give you a quick 30-second commercial. Right after church today, we have a Sunday school hour, and there's a new quarter that we're walking into. Last October, we introduced a new tool for parents, a new tool for families called FaithPath. If you would like to come to the Faith Path classroom, I'm teaching about some of those changes that we have to navigate as we enter parenthood. And it begins with parent dedication. So that's what we're going to talk about next week or today. You can go into Home Point, grab your stuff, come back and talk to me. But just sidebar, children is a huge change. What's another change that we've all gone through? Man on the moon. Who said that? Was that Scott Siverling? Yeah. Right? One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. Accepting Christ brings a significant change in our life, no doubt about it. Oh, yeah. Digital photography. I remember those old Polaroids that you would, you know. You remember that? I grew up with those. You bet I did. Mega churches. That's a huge change in our world. We're still trying to figure out, what does that mean? Is it because we've become less connected? And so we have a desire to be kind of, hidden in the crowd. Yeah, someone had their hand raised over here. Social media. What'd you say?
Marriage.
Marriage. How long ago was that for you, Melvin?
I'm not telling.
He doesn't remember. That's right. He knows better. Nope. That's an old wise fox right there. Yep. The internet. Yeah, I was in high school when the internet starts to come out, and there was this new buzz about being online. You're like, what is online? What? And I remember them throwing all kinds of new cables down, trenching new cables for this new thing coming in. Yeah, internet's a huge deal. Guys, we've gone through changes constantly in our life. And for me, as I look at these changes, I can't help but in some ways be really frustrated with them. Because I look at where you guys are. I'm going to kind of navigate away from my notes for a little bit. I look at where you guys are in life. And it seems like that for me, life can kind of be summarized like this. Big looping changes in technology, right? I remember sitting in the living room with my brother Wes when we were, I think we were watching like Little House on the Prairie with the old TVs that you flip the dials from channel U to channel 1 to channel 2 to channel 3 to change channels. And sometimes it also had that volume knob, remember? Because if you couldn't quite hear it, you turned the volume up. And guess whose job it was to go change channels and to go change the volumes? The kids' job. Some of you guys are like, what? You guys had to do that? What? And so my mom and dad, they were kind of reminiscing about walking up hills both ways to school. Remember the same sort of conversation that we have now today with our children, but it's manifested itself a little differently. And Wes leans over to me. No joke, he goes, when we're old men, you know what we're going to be talking about? I said, what's that, Wes? We had to get up and change the channel. He's so right. I mean, now we have this thing called the remote that we can just sit and stay and bump through them. I mean, technology has really moved pretty quickly, but as I look at all of the changes through the history of life and through the timeline of life, I can't help but wonder, are the changes that we're experiencing accelerating? How fast is the slope? What is the rate of change? To me, I'm overwhelmed with the rate of change right now. I just got a cell phone a year and a half ago, and it's already obsolete. Got a brand new computer. Well, brand new. I got a computer when I first moved here 4.5 years ago, and now we're talking about upgrading it. Why? Because the software's obsolete. Because not everyone's in sync. And you got to stay synchronized. That slope, the rise and the run that you math guys are studying right now in high school, the rate of change. It's no longer a pitch that is manageable. It's not a 412. Man, it seems like it's just sharp. And I wonder, are we able to sustain it? And I was having a conversation with one of the elders about 2 months ago, and I said something, a quote that I'm going to share with you a little later. And their response was, this is the sort of conversation that we've been having for about 10 years. See, the reality is we cannot stay where we are. We all know that. If we know that change is here, and if we know that change is on our doorstep, we know that we can't stay where we want to stay.
Because summer's coming. Because fall's coming. Because winter's coming. And so I'm not just talking about the seasonal changes. I'm not just talking about the technological changes. I might even be talking about the metaphorical changes in your life. Some of you, you're looking forward to next week, or you're looking forward to 2 weeks from now, because that's when your vacation's scheduled. And you just can't wait to get away. You're just like, oh man, if I could just make it till next week, or if I could just make it till next month. Others of you, you're looking forward to maybe getting married, right, Dylan? I know Mariah's not, but Dylan is. I'm just kidding, just teasing. But we all have these different chapters that we kind of look forward to, that we're excited about, maybe we're excited about. Others of us, we might not be so excited. But those changes are happening, and those are the metaphorical changes. Maybe you're looking forward to a wedding. Maybe you're not looking forward to a wedding. Maybe for some of you, and I know some of you are in here, you're looking forward to your very first child. You can't wait till that baby's born. That's the next season of change for you. Others of you, maybe you're looking forward to the second child or the third child, because the fourth child, man, that's more change. I mean, so you're looking forward to all these other changes that are happening in your world. You know that the seasons are coming. You know that the changes are coming. Maybe for some of you, you can't wait to take your child to kindergarten for the very first day. Or you're like Mandy and I, and we're looking forward to getting Madison out of the house, right? Because she's graduating this year, so you're excited about her graduation, or you're looking forward to a change. Maybe you're not looking forward to that change. Maybe it's not exciting for you to lose one of your children to graduation. Or perhaps it's not graduation. Maybe it's something else. Maybe it's empty nesting. Maybe you're looking forward to you're looking at your life season, and you just got used to this side of the slope, you just got used to this side of the circle, and all of a sudden you're looking across from the kitchen table, the dining room table, and you're recognizing, well, you're not recognizing the person that you married 20 years ago. And you're entering a new chapter of your life called empty nesting. What do you do in those moments with that change? Others of you, you're looking around and you don't recognize anybody because they're already all gone. They've already all died and gone home. And so you're looking at your next chapter in life going, maybe it's death. Maybe that's my next season. We all have a next season, church. I don't know what your next season is specifically, but I do know that the constant thing is, like Heraclitus said, everything changes. Nothing remains still. We constantly have to move because there is no guarantee that we can stay where we are. If we have to move to the next season, something changes. And so the progression of change, I just want to show this to you. I think this is really fascinating. Whatever your next is, whatever your next step is, whatever your next thing is that you're looking forward to, or that you're looking on with a lot of dread, it kind of stair steps. Because whatever's next leads to a transition, and that transition requires a change, and then that change, regardless of whether it's a good or a bad one, it will result in stress. That's the problem with change. We all struggle with this area. And as we look at our world and as the changes continue to come at a rate that we might not be able to sustain, guess what happens? We're a world full of stress because we're all in constant motion. So this series, Constant Changes, is all about how to navigate that change appropriately. It's how to not spin out of control through all of the seasons of chaos and cycles and change. Thomas Aquinas, that one quote that I sent to somebody that spurred kind of this whole concept was this. Thomas Aquinas said the only real way to guarantee the preservation of your ship is to never let it leave port. Let that sink in. The only real way to guarantee the preservation of your ship is to never let it leave port. In some ways, that's true. But in other ways, it's not. Because what if the hurricanes come? What if the storms come? You see, we have this concept that I want to stay right where I am, but we cannot stay where we are. I've been very jealous of the generation in front of me because it seems like that their rate of change was a lot more gradual than the rate of change that I see coming. And I shared this openly. I said, I'm very jealous of the generation in front of me. I'm very worried about the generation behind me. Because if this is the rate of change that we're going down, all I see is the whole system's going to implode. And we're just going to whoop, done. Then what? What do we do in those moments? How do we keep pace with an ever-changing world? We cannot avoid change. We cannot avoid change. We cannot stay where we are. Something's going to change in your life, and when you feel like you've got it all figured out, you better buckle up because the next change is coming. I want you to turn your Bibles to Ecclesiastes chapter 1 as we begin this series. I want to kind of camp here in Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes chapter 1, and I want to take you to verse 3, and I just got to say this. I knew that Phil was going to preach 3 weeks ago, and if you've not heard this sermon, you could go online, you could check us out online for those of you who are viewing. We're excited that you're here. I want to say hi to you. But Phil knocked it out of the park when he preached here. Man, I enjoyed that so much. I was able to go back and hear what he said. And he just kind of was this guy that just imparted wisdom to us. He just kind of said, here's all the changes that I've seen in my lifetime. Phil and I did not compare notes. I did not ask Phil, hey, could you preach that sermon? I did not know he was going to preach that sermon. And this sermon has been slated for a couple of months now. So I just love how God kind of orchestrates the conversation to continue through the seasons of change. So just a shout out, if you've not seen it, you need to go back and watch it. If you'd like copies of the DVD, we're selling them for $19.99, three small payments. Just kidding. You can have a copy, okay? But he ended his message on Ecclesiastes at the very last verse or two of Ecclesiastes, and this is kind of the summary of the matter. I'd like to take us to the beginning of Ecclesiastes, though, because I think Ecclesiastes really speaks to this whole navigating through the circles of change. How do we keep pace with an ever-changing world? It kind of speaks to that in chapters 1, 2, 3, and 4. It actually speaks about it through the whole book, but I just want to camp out real quickly on chapter 1, verse 3, if you would. It says this: what does man gain from all of his labor at which he toils under the sun? Listen to the words of the teacher here. It says, generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun sets, and it hurries back to where it had risen. The wind blows to the south, and then it goes again to the north, and round it goes, ever returning its course. All streams flow into the sea, yet the sea is never full. To the place the streams come from, there they will return again. All things are wearisome, more than anyone can say. The eye never has enough of seeing. Listen to this. The eye never has enough of seeing, verse 8, nor the ear its fill of hearing. Compare that to what Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3, that in the last days, a generation will rise up, and they will be ever learning, but never able to understand truth. Goes on to say, verse 9, what has been done will be done again. What has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there something of which somebody could say, look, hey, there's something new. It was here already long ago, and it was here before our time. And then verse 11 is one of the most downing verses in all of Scripture. It says this: there is no remembrance of men of old, and even those who are yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow. And you stop and you think about that as I already shared a quote of Heraclitus. I'm able just to give you information, facts, or in some cases, maybe just inferences on some people that we can assume. But I didn't know Heraclitus. It was 500 years before Jesus. I didn't know Thomas Aquinas. He was 1,200 years after Jesus. Truth be known, I didn't really even know my great-grandfather. I mean, I knew him. I hung out with him. I arm wrestled with him. But I didn't work with him. I didn't know his worldview. I didn't know what drove Arthur Roland. I didn't know those things. I know my grandfathers, but do I really know them? And what the author of Ecclesiastes is really saying is, how can you really, really, really know things? Through all of these changes, the thing that continues to spin around and around and around and around is the sun and the water. Change is constant. change is constant. See, if you go back to verse 2, I intentionally left this out because I think this is significant. What does verse 2 say in some of your Bibles? Someone say it louder, I can't hear.
Vanity of vanities.
You're reading probably a New American Standard, What I Know of You. It's New King James. You surprised me. Okay. So the New King James and the New American Standard have the same thing. Vanity, vanity. All of life is vanity. Some of you have a different word. What is it? Meaningless. Meaningless. That's right. Meaningless. I want you to circle this word because it's translated in kind of this loosey-goosey sort of way because this is a tough Hebrew word. In fact, it's the same Hebrew word. This is really going to have you go for a mind trip. It's the same Hebrew word that Adam and Eve named one of their sons. Abel. See, they named Cain promised or redeemer. They named Abel or Hevel, H-E-V-E-L. And that's the same Hebrew word in Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 2. And it can be translated vanity. It can be translated meaningless. How would you like to have that be your name? How would you like to grow up in the shadow of Cain, who was redeemer, your whole world? And yet the author of Ecclesiastes says everything under the earth, everything under the sun is meaningless. Everything under the sun is vanity. It's a tough word for us to translate, and it doesn't really mean meaningless. What it literally can be translated into is vapor. That's the real meaning of this word. Smoke. Mist. You see, smoke has this weird aura about it because as you see smoke from the distance, it looks something physical. It looks something tangible. It looks like a solid. But when you go to reach for smoke, what happens? It's not solid at all. It's gas. You reach for this thing that you can't hold. And that's what life is. Life is not just some solid, tangible thing that you can have concrete ideas with. Kind of a depressing thought, isn't it? It's constant change. It's this smoke that we go after. See, time, he says, in time, nothing ever changes. How can that be? Because I saw the remote thing change my world. I saw cell phones change my world. I saw marriage change my world. I saw children change my world. How can the author of Ecclesiastes say that nothing ever changes? You see, change is the constant change in life. And it's this difficult, intangible enigma in life. It's this odd grasp. And that's why this idea of trying to chase change is so difficult. In time, nothing ever changes. See, your life will come and go. It says later that like 1,000 years is night to God in Ecclesiastes. But through those 1,000 years or through the span of your lifetime, maybe you're given 70 years, maybe you're given 37 years, maybe you're given 107 years, through your span of life, you might see lots of changes. You might see man be put on the moon. You might see technology change and revolutionize your world. But when you're gone, when you're dead, you know what still stays? The sun continues to move. The ocean continues to ebb and flow. The mountains continue to stay where they are. Nothing in this world changes. The world is constant. And it is, all of it, all of life is this chasing after the wind. If we get caught up in the circles, we have a way of spinning out of control, and life doesn't make sense at all or any longer. The author goes on to say, there is one certain thing in life, death. He summarizes basically all of Ecclesiastes that it doesn't matter if you're rich or poor, it doesn't matter if you're male or female, it doesn't matter if you're wise or a fool. You all will suffer the same fate. One day, all of us will be gone. And all that we've worked so hard for, the stresses of life in our job, the stresses of life in our volunteer, it's going to be someone else's to worry about. You don't have to worry about it the way that you're worrying about it. You don't have to stress out. But here's the secret. Here's the secret, and I love this, that through the entire book of Ecclesiastes, six times the author kind of leans in during the darkest parts of the book, and he says, but wait, before you get all depressed, before you get all melancholy, this is the gift of God. He says that six times. If you want to read through Ecclesiastes this week, look for the phrase, gift of God. Circle that in the Bible, because it's in the darkest spots of the book, and he says, in your darkest hour, this is what you should hold on to. Embrace Hevel. See, if life is meaningless, if everything that we're chasing is meaningless, it doesn't matter what we build or what we don't build. One of the best things that we could do is just embrace that it's okay. Embrace that it's okay. Accept that all things in your life are out of your control. Accept that. Just go with the fact that God has your circle. You don't. Oh, wait, Steve, are you saying that, like, I shouldn't be concerned, I shouldn't be a good steward? No. I think you should still be a good steward, but I don't think that maybe we should worry about the things that are out of our control. And guess what's out of our control? A lot of things, everything. Do your best at it. Whatever you do, work as though you're working for the Lord, not for man. Whatever you do, work as though you're working for the Lord, not for man. But give your life as an offering to Him every single day. Every single circle, every single cycle, every single season. Except Hevel. Solomon calls these the gifts of life. Enjoying the simple things in life. Enjoying a good steak. Enjoying a good campfire. Enjoying good company. Just find the moments where God is there. I've been reading a new book. I can't even remember the title, but I've been reading a new book. I just started on Friday. Sorry about that. I should have brought it up here. I didn't know I was going to say this, but I love what the author says, and I'll refer to it later, but I think it's something to the effect about how you win in the locker room before you win on the field. It's something to that effect, and it's about team building. One of the things that this author says that I just thought was so rich in this book, I think it was chapter 3 or 4, he says this. He says, I vowed no longer to have any bad days in my life. I thought, what? I'll give bad moments, but I will not give bad days. He said, if I'm having one of those days where you could just kind of chalk it up, you hang your hat up, you hang your coat up, you hang your work boots up, and you're like, that's it, I'm done. I'm finding paradise in Caribbean somewhere. Whatever that is in your moment, he would say to you, before you chalk it up as a bad day, start finding the good moments in that day. Start finding all the little blessings. All the little things that you could say, God was with me here. Man, I had a rough patch, but man, I saw something awesome here. And just write those things out. Count your every blessing and name them one by one. And in those moments, you'll be able to say, I will not have a bad day today. I'll have bad moments, but I will not have a bad day today. And that's what the whole book of Ecclesiastes is all about. Listen, embrace Hevel. Embrace that you can't control it all. Embrace that you have no control over life at all. But enjoy the moments as they come. And that's the beauty. That's the beauty of this whole idea that through change, you can find some peace. Through the seasons, you can find some rest. You can't control things. You're not even guaranteed things in life. But they are gifts to you. And through these constant changes, my encouragement to you is to find the constant lines. And we're going to pick it up from there next week, but I really want you to think about that. Through these constant changes that are in your life, I want you to look for constant lines, because they're there. As you intersect that line through your season of change, through that season of life, that whatever it is that you're going through, you'll intersect, you'll come face to face, you'll nose to nose, right, with a solid line. And what I love about this author is that he starts, if you check this out, he starts with the end in mind as he gives us some encouragement. He calls every one of us to remember the circles are going to stop. One day they'll stop for you. One day those changes are going to stop for you. So to keep from spinning in circles in your life, keep the end in mind. Start with the end in mind. Trusting completely that God allows you to enjoy your life as though you experience your life. Trusting God completely allows you to be able to trust in him completely. It allows you to be able to enjoy those experiences as you go through life. I have no idea, church. I have no idea, person in the pew. I have no idea, whoever you are, what the next season is in your life. I don't know what God has planned for you. But what I do know is that change is coming. Now, I want you to think about this in those changes. Kobe, could you come up here for a second? Why don't you grab this? Why don't you find, how old are you?
33.
You're 33. Go ahead and walk. Go, 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 go. Stop. Okay, so hold on. Next time you're going through just some junk in life, I want you to get out a tape measure. I want you to pull that tape measure up, and I want you to look at your span in life. Kobe, this is how far away from greatness you are right now, all right? I'm just kidding. Some of you are like, what did you just say? Just stay with me for a second. Some of you, I love how the ruler is a good indicator of life, because there are 12 inches in a foot, and there are 12 months in a year. And some of you think that whatever it is that you're facing right now is insurmountable. You think right now you can't overcome. You think right now it is way too overwhelming. Get the ruler out. Get the tape measure out. And put it on the map. Put it on the map. Because 33 years isn't that long. Melvin, your turn. Come on up here. We picked on him a little bit. Let's just see. How old are you, Mel? What? How old are you, Mel? I don't have enough tape, he said. How old are you? Tell me how old you are. Jane, how old is he? All right, go. Kobe, you only had 33 years. Keep going. Just keep walking, buddy. Walk in circles. Somebody give him a point. Nick, give him a point there. Bye, Melvin. Oh, just kidding. Keep going. You're not done. Stop. You see the distance in life that Melvin has traveled compared to 33. Through your seasons of change, find those constant lines. Look at the moment for what it is. That's how we're going to navigate and not lose our mind through them. God, thank you so much for this church. Thank you so much for this truth. Lord, I pray that I would hear these things. I pray that I might embrace these things. I pray that you might change me, because ultimately the only significant change in life is that you would transform me into looking more like you. Lord, I pray that that would be someone else's testimony.
Love won't leave you hanging, oh, I'm for life.
I caught you just in time. Love is gonna